Donc, bonjour, merci à tous d'être venus aujourd'hui pour ce séminaire du regroupement québécois sur les matériaux de pointe. Donc, aujourd'hui, on va avoir la visite de Jacopo Carusotto. Jacopo est professeur à l'Université de Trento en Italie. Il est aussi membre du BEC Center, du Centre de recherche sur les condensats Bose-Einstein, qui s'appelle depuis très peu le Centre Pitayevski, en l'honneur de M. Pitayevski, de l'équation Gross-Pitayevski. Je connais Jacopo depuis plusieurs années. Je l'ai connu durant mon postdoctorat, donc c'est un grand plaisir de l'avoir aujourd'hui. C'est un spécialiste des fluides quantiques de lumière, qui va nous parler aujourd'hui, mais aussi beaucoup de tout ce qui est en lien avec les propriétés topologiques de la lumière. Donc, Jacopo, merci beaucoup et bonne présentation. Voilà.
Donc, c'est grand merci, Philippe, pour m'avoir accueilli ici à Montréal. C'est un grand plaisir de passer un mois ici à l'université, discuter avec tous les gens ici et démarrer des projets très intéressants, très excitants. Et aujourd'hui, je vais vous raconter quelque chose sur les flux des lumières. Mais on m'a dit de passer à l'anglais, donc c'est ce que je vais faire. So, the idea today is to... Okay, good. Is to start with a kind of general question about the fluids of light and fluid of matter. So the general, say, the general framework in which all these projects live is on the thinking of what is different between light and matter. So from our daily experience, we know that matter can be touched. Okay. So matter can be touched. It has mechanical properties. It really reacts to our mechanical manipulation. While light is something that cannot be easily touched, it's just composed of electromagnetic waves which travel around space at a fixed speed c and don't do much of interest, at least from the point of view of collective behaviors, unless something special happens. So light which is emitted from the projector or from the screen and goes to your retinas, it does not do much interest in between. Just photons are emitted on the screen and travel to your retina. And that's basically it. So how can one force light to behave like matter? Is that possible? What do you need to do? What are the crucial ingredients which are missing in ordinary light to behave as matter? And in order to do that, the main two things, after a bit of thinking, that are lacking are the mass of the photonic particles and interactions between photons. So the molecules of air, just to take a very concrete example, just move around the room at some speed, which can be whatever direction and whatever speed. And in order for a particle to have a free speed, a free value of the speed, you need a finite. On the other hand, the particles, the molecules in air also collide with each other all the time to give rise to collective behaviors. So in order to do that, you need the photons to acquire some collisional properties among them. So the two critical points that one needs to engineer in order then to create a fluid of light is to have, to force photons to have a finite mass.
You have this one here.
Okay. And to have photons to interact with binary interactions. This. So how can you do that? So the mass is sketched in that picture. You see that whenever you confine light between two plane parallel mirrors, it's immediate that light acquires a finite mass just because of confinement in the third direction. So if you write the dispersion of electromagnetic waves between two plane parallel mirrors, they have exactly the same form as relativistic dispersion with a mass which is set by the confinement. You confine light, confinement gives a zero point energy to the photonic particle, the photon in this direction, and then the motion along the plane is exactly the one of a massive particle. So this is the way to force photons to happen. It's a cartoonish picture, but it's actually the physics behind it. To have photons to interact with binary interactions,
one needs to obtain a vertex of this form. So if you are familiar with nonlinear optics, you recognize that that kind of diagrams correspond to the chi-tree nonlinearity of optical nonlinear. So a nonlinearity where the polarization has a component which is proportional to the cube of the electric. If you write the Hamiltonian corresponding to that nonlinear term, you get a four photon object, so a term with four electric fields, which corresponds in diagrammatic terms to this kind of picture. If you have done some quantum field course in your career, you remember that those kind of diagrams are common in quantum electrodynamics. They are called Heisenberg-Euler terms, which come from the polarizability of vacuum. In particular, that specific diagram is the exchange of an electron and a positron in vacuum. So two photons travel in vacuum, they exchange a pair of electrons and positrons, and they get in this way scattered. Of course, in vacuum, this effect is extremely small. We are used to linear Maxwell's equations, which are a good setup to describe electrodynamics. But for instance, if you worked with gamma rays, those terms would be very important because they are much more energetic. So the intermediate non-resonant terms would play less of a role. In a solid, where you can replace electron-positron pairs with electron-hole excitations in the solid, one gains a huge factor, 10 to the 36 in particular. And in this way, one gets effective nonlinear optics in a material, which are used in everyday life for any kind of nonlinear optics phenomena. So you see that these two ingredients, the mass and the interactions, conspire to give to the photon, to the photons, an assembly of photons, the properties of a fluid. Massive particles which interact with each other, which is exactly what happens in air. But this is not the end of the story. Physics is more complicated than that, mostly because the photons continuously decay. So you cannot store photons in a container and leave them there for a year. After a short time, typically of the order at most of nanoseconds, they would have disappeared, absorbed or radiatively gone. So the physics of a fluid of light, even though it can display collective behaviors, it will in any case have the very different property of being non-equilibrium fluid. Non-equilibrium, I mean that since the photons escape because of losses, they need to be continuously replenished by some light source. So in this way, what is contained in your cavity will not something at thermal equilibrium, but will be something which at best is in a driven dissipative steady state, which is the steady state between pumping and losses. So it's a system that cannot be described with usual terms of equilibrium quantum mechanics, but rather require non-equilibrium statistical mechanics for a proper description. And these, rather than being a hindrance, as people believed in the early days, it's becoming more and more a resource because it can be exploited to do new physics with this system, not just repeating what has been done with atoms or with liquid helium. So in particular, having the radiative coupling of the cavity with the external world means that one can use tailored laser beams to inject a photon fluid with the properties that one desires. And also one can get information on what the photon fluid is doing just by looking at the light which is radiatively emitted from the cavity. So in this way, one has access to imprint the desired properties and to look at the system, which is something that if you have ever worked in cold atoms, you know how difficult it can be. There you need spatial imaging systems to detect the system, and they get more and more complicated as you look for finer properties like correlation functions. Here you can measure any correlation function of the fluid of light just by detecting the correlations in the clicks on the photodetectors that you are using to detect the light. That's enough to obtain information on the fluid. So this is a very important asset that one can explore. And indeed, one of the first and more celebrated experiments in this sense has been the observation of Bose-Einstein condensation in a fluid of light, which is very closely analog to what has been done with atomic gases, just by ramping the density of the photon gas, which means putting more and more photons, one goes from a broad thermal distribution to a distribution with a narrow peak at the center, which corresponds to the condensate. And this is just pumping harder the system, so to inject more and more photons in the system. Here, just for comparison, is the same picture done for ultra-cold atoms, where you again see that a thermal cloud becomes a cloud narrower with a narrow peak in the center. With just a difference that here one tunes the density. For photons, it's easier to tune the density. For atoms, it's easier to tune the temperature. But that's a technical difference. It's not an essential difference. The physics is similar. Then what people have tried to do again with the photon BC is to measure interference fringes, like Ketterle did. This is actually the first experiment by Cornell. This is the following experiment by Ketterle 2 months later, rubidium, sodium. Here is interference fringes with the BEC, showing that the BEC is characterized not only by a peak at k equals zero in the population, but also by long distance coherence functions, which are actually mathematically equivalent definitions. Here, just for this is another example of observation of quantized vortices in a photon BC, again by group of Benoit Devaux and Lesidou. But now, okay, what I presented is very similar to what people have done with atomic beam. So now the natural question is to see what new can be done with photon BCs exploiting their non-equilibrium properties. And this is a short summary of some experiments that have been done in the group of Jacqueline Bloch at CEDESEN in Paris in the last few years, been sort of a series of experiments which have culminated in the observation of low dimensional condensates with peculiar statistical properties. Now it's good to make just a step back. You remember from your StatMech elementary course that phase transitions, which are spontaneously breaking a continuous symmetry, like a Heisenberg model of ferromagnetism or BEC, only happen in a high enough dimension. In particular, it's a transition which breaks a one parameter group, like U1 or magnetization on a plane, can only survive at two dimensions t equals zero or at finite temperature in three dimensions or higher. In 1D, this is blocked by the so-called Heisenberg-Mermin-Wagner theorem, which tells that small wave vector fluctuations will destroy the condensate and give rise to some long wavelength fluctuations in the condensate. It's like having a piecewise condensate. So if I have an object which is 1 kilometer long, it will be formed by pieces, say 1 meter long each, which are in a condensate, but are not mutually coherent. So it is something which locally is like a condensate, but globally is not. So this is the term of equilibrium statistical mechanics. And in the early 2000s, Michiel Wouters has rediscovered something which was known from the 70s by Graham and Haken, but had been completely forgotten, as it unfortunately often happens in physics. Things are rediscovered at a rate of roughly 30 years, which is the lifetime of human memory. So in 30 years, perhaps some of your papers will be published again. So actually, this was jokes apart, this paper of Graham and Haken is a milestone in modern science. It has an incredible depth, even though it's done with very simple techniques. Really, they nail down the physical problem. So it's really very instructive to go and look at it. We were ignorant. We didn't know about that paper. And we redid basically the same thing from a slightly different language. It was the first paper that Michele and I did together when he arrived in Trento as a postdoc. And basically, we calculated the correlation function, the two-point correlation function in space for a photon condensate. And we recovered that the non-equilibrium condensate has more or less the same statistical properties as an equilibrium condensate at a temperature which is set by the decay rate. Which, if you think in terms of fluctuation dissipation theorem, is a kind of reasonable to expect. But we were even more ignorant. We didn't know the work of our neighbors in Roma, just 600 kilometers away. And we didn't know anything about the KPZ physics, Kardar, Parisi, Zhang physics. Parisi is the Parisi that got Nobel Prize a couple of years ago for his work in Starlink. And actually, there's been few works by, mostly by Hud Altman, Anna Minguzzi and Leonie Canet in Grenoble, and Marina Szymanska and Sebastian Dill, different groups around Europe, and Michele himself, who realized that the actual statistical mechanics ensemble that you need to use to study non-equilibrium condensation is the KPZ universality class. Since we are dealing with a non-equilibrium system, the concept of universality class is not as well defined as at equilibrium statistical mechanics, but still KPZ is one of the big classes that describes many things like propagation of wood fires, growth of interfaces, which was the original topic of Parisi's work, and here non-equilibrium condensates. And what the group of Jacqueline and co-workers did was to capitalize on their extremely stable system, to whose stability also Philippe has contributed during his postdoc. There are plenty of technical steps which allow to get a system which is extremely quiet from extrinsic sources of noise. So one can take measurements which are only determined by the intrinsic physics of the statistical ensemble. And say this is the density distribution of this one-dimensional condensate. This is a system of pillars in which it's confined. If you don't want to know the details, just think of a one-dimensional wire. If you want to know the details, ask Philippe, because there are some technical tricks why this very strange lattice had to be used to get a very stable system. But just think of a 1D system, and you measure the correlation function at 2 points, and you see that the correlation decays outside the central region. When the 2 points are farther away than a few 50 microns, you lose the coherence. So the spatial coherence is very similar to what one expected in equilibrium stat-mech, but the part of temporal dependence of the correlation function, so it's in the T, this is the key novelty of this experiment, which was the first time this physics was observed in this kind of photon beam. If some of you are in laser physics, just think of this like a pixel, a one-dimensional pixel. So a system of two plane parallel mirrors, some lateral confinement, and lasing occurs in the longitudinal direction. It's not an edge emitter, but it's a vertical cavity surface emitting. Just the technical details for laser people in the audience. So this was the measurement of the coherent function. And here is the statistical mechanics analysis. So I have no time in going into all the details of the universality, the universal scalings, but there are two important points. Are these These are the log of the first order coherence function, basically the field-field correlation function, as you measure in a Young interference experiment, the fringe amplitude in a Young interference experiment, you see that it drops with a power law. Log goes as a power law of the time, this strange two-third power, while here in position it goes as delta x. This means that this dependence is an exponential. Log is like dx exponential. This is dt to the two-third is a sort of stretched exponential. And these are the predictions that one expects from the KPZ universality. So the correlation functions of this system follow KPZ ensemble, of course, up to some point. Here in space, you cannot go to larger distance because basically you exit the sample. In time, because other physics sets in of the family of the so-called charlottowns. You heard about charlottowns in any laser physics course, is the minimum line width that the laser can have. And this is what determines the physics at very long times. So KPZ is the intermediate one. So these are the scale power law scalings. And here is even stronger evidence of KPZ physics, is that if one plots the data as a function of this peculiar combination, all points lie on a universal curve, which means that the system has a critical property. So if you look at the system on a longer length scale, you see the same physics, provided you also rescale the other quantities. Here is the. So this is a very strong evidence that KPZ universality exists in a laser. So this is very interesting for Giorgio Parisi because it's a result of statistical mechanics. It's interesting for quantum opticians because it's the role of quantum fluctuations which determines very complicated dynamics. But it's also very important if you want to use these systems as a laser, because it gives you an upper bound to the coherence that you can expect from a laser. So you cannot build a bigger laser to get higher power without being affected by these fluctuations. So fluctuations will always be between your feet. You will always be disturbed by this fluctuation method. So if you want to design a very quiet laser, you have to take this into account. Very good. So all this is for a physics of photons which are weakly interacting, which means that they can be described in terms of Maxwell equations plus a nonlinear polarization term. And possibly plus some noise term, sort of stochastic Maxwell equations. The question, which is nowadays most investigated by the community, is there what happens if the nonlinearity becomes very strong? So very strong means that you enter into the so-called photon blockade region, where photons behave like billiard balls. On a billiard table, you cannot have overlapping billiard balls. At most, they touch. They cannot be at the same point. Kind of trivial statement, of course. For photons, it's not that straightforward, because photons in Maxwell are completely impenetrable objects. Can you make photons to behave like billiard balls? So this was a problem. It was already on the arena of physics when I was a PhD student. 25 years ago. And the main idea is this kind of diagram. So you have a single mode cavity, whose state is determined by the number of photons it contains. So if the nonlinearity of the cavity is so large that the presence of a very single photon is enough to shift by nonlinearity the cavity mode by an amount which is larger than the cavity line width, if you shine a laser, which is on resonance with the transition from 0 to 1, which is basically the empty cavity, the bare cavity frequency, you see that one photon can enter the cavity, but not the second one. Because the two photon state is shifted from twice your laser frequency by an amount which is larger than the line width of the state. So the second photon cannot enter, which means that the photons are effectively impenetrable objects. If one photon is sitting in a cavity, you cannot have a second photon entering the same time. This means the photons are impenetrable. So there's been a lot of works starting from the first proposal by Hatachi Mamoglu of this physics, with a lot of progress. Many different systems have been considered. This is a shiny Eiffel Tower. I don't need to tell you in which city this experiment has been done. This is done at the Google Labs in Santa Barbara using circuit QD systems by Pedram, Rushan, and co-workers. But of course, other people have been done it in superconducting circuits. This is done by so-called Rydberg EIT, which means to use an atomic gas, which is optically dressed with a sequence of lasers, so that the interactions between the Rydberg atoms, which are big objects, are so strong that forbid them to host more than one polariton at the point, with a blockade radius, which is the radius of your billiard ball, which can be of large, of the order of micrometers. Hundreds of nanos is fine, perhaps even bigger in some specific experiments. So you think how big this is to have an object, where photons cannot approach more than one micro. So it's really a bulky, nonlinear phenomenon. And this is what is being studied in this experiment by John Simon at Chicago. He was visiting here at some point.
He went to Stanford. He's now at Stanford.
Yeah.
He didn't have time to come.
Okay. So
he was supposed to.
Yeah. Hopefully, we'll come at some point.
I suppose.
Yes. So he has moved all his lab to Stanford. So this was the experiment he did during his first appointment in Chicago, where he used these kind of billiard ball photons combined with another idea, which is magnetism for light. So let me just stop for a second. Keep in mind that photons can be made strongly interacting, but think back. If you build a cavity which is formed like a periscope, so normal ring cavity, this is a ring cavity, and you tilt like a boat. Okay? What happens if you insert in the cavity the image of a person which is vertical, head up? It will go around the ring cavity. And since the ring cavity is not flat, it will come back to the same point rotated by some angle. This you know very well if you have ever built a periscope. You know, periscopes are like this. I don't know if you ever tried to build a periscope which is tuck, tuck, tuck. You know what happens. You don't see the ship horizontal, but you see the ship rotated. If you don't believe, just do it. I did it by mistake. And it was not really a properly working periscope. And this idea of rotating, you know, if going around the cavity, the image rotates, this means that the fluid of light, which is present in the cavity, will be somehow rotated. Okay. If you want to understand, just go to John's paper. Very difficult reading, but it's very instructive. But think another thing. You all know about the Coriolis force. What is the form? It's V cross rotation, V cross omega. What is the form of a Lorentz force in a magnetic field? V cross B. So particles in a rotating frame behave like charged particles in a magnetic. So photons in this twisted cavity, which is somehow rotating, will feel the sort of Coriolis effect. So these photons will be sort of magnetic particles. So they will feel some external magnetic field. So they will behave like, say, electrons in a solid under strong magnetic field. You know, electrons in a solid have strong repulsion coming from Coulomb, and they see the magnetic field, strong magnetic field. And together, the two ingredients lead to a new form of matter, which is the so-called fractional quantum Hall gas, which is a very strongly correlated fluid of matter with remarkable properties. And this is the long-term goal of this experiment by John Simon, which here was able to build Landau levels for photons, which show that photons are wavy particles filling magnetic field. And they also show photon blockade. So the two ingredients are there to then start doing a fractional quantum Hall physics with photons. And there is indeed a first experiment being done, which is this work, this Nature work in 2020, where they were able to create a baby version of fractional quantum Hall fluid formed by just two photons. It's the smallest system of two strongly interacting photons in the presence of a magnetic. So these particles don't like to hit each other, they keep rotating around each other. So this experimental evidence of this physics can be obtained, as I told you already a couple of times, by looking at the light which is emitted by the sun. So just by putting some photodetector at the exit, making some momentum, orbital angular momentum selective imaging of the light, emitted light, they can reconstruct with quantum optics techniques measuring correlation between the different states, they are able to infer the fractional quantum Hall nature of the two photons which are present in the cavity. So now the challenge is to obtain photon fluids which are larger than just two photons. To do that, it's very complicated things because all the schemes which have been proposed so implemented so far to inject light into a cavity are not enough to scale up, and something new has to be done. And the winning proposal, which is now being set up, is this one based on using population inverted two-level emitters. So two-level emitters where population is brought to the upper state, which are then able to emit photons preferentially at the frequency of their natural frequency. So, and you know that FQH states have the property of having a many-body gap on top of your final state. If you have an FQH state, this is very robust against temperature because it has a gap above it. So in order to excite it, you have to put a sizable amount of energy. So the idea is optically to exploit this fact that the target state has an energy gap above to only pump photons at a frequency which is omega naught, which is the frequency set by the emitters. So you see, you pump here, you pump here, you pump here, but you cannot pump above because above you have the many body gap which blocks you. So you are forced to stay here. So your population in your system accumulates in the desired target state. Cannot go up because there is an energy gap above. So you cannot be wrong, you cannot excite by mistake a higher energetic state, because there is energy gap protected. That's the key. So this has not been used yet in FQH systems, even though Onur Mujalila has done a lot of calculations, as well as this wonderful paper by the Girvins group that really strongly suggests you to read. It gives some microscopic understanding on this physics. But experimentally, it has been used in a broader system, which is a Mott insulator of light, which is also a very strange state of matter, because it's electric. A Max Mott insulator basically is a lattice, where each side of the lattice is only occupied by one and only one part. It's like an egg box where you find an egg at each hole. You cannot have two eggs at the same hole, otherwise you made an omelette. Here, the same happens with photons, which are billiard balls. Or you can imagine that in the triangle, which is at the beginning of a billiard match, you put all the billiard balls one next to each other in a compact state. And this is what happens in this other geometry. And John Simon, him again, has realized the first example of Mott insulator of light, this time in a circuit QED device based on superconducting architecture. This was done together with his friend, Dave Schuster. And now both are moved to Stanford, and we are looking forward to the new result. So this is a Mott insulator of light, which is really one photon per site of the lattice. Why is this so interesting? Again, it's because it's a non-equilibrium system. We don't just repeat what Immanuel Bloch did with atoms in 2000. Now we are doing this in a non-equilibrium system. And this was the subject of the thesis of Fabio Tcalefi, which I forgot to update the slide, has been successfully defended. He got his PhD, not expected, but he did get it. And he calculated all the excitation modes of this fluid, finding very interesting features which come from the interplay of strong interactions, quantum correlations, and driving and dissipation. So in this way, putting all together, he was able to, for instance, calculate the response of the fluid of light to an external probe, pump and probe physics, and showing some very interesting modes. This is a Goldstone branch associated to the spontaneously broken symmetry at BEC. But since this is a strongly interacting system, this diffusive mode has kind of different properties. It's very visible. Good. So this is somehow the land where people are working now. So this is really the frontier. The very long-term frontier, if I have just a few minutes left, is about what can be done new with these systems in light and also with cold atoms, which are also now at the frontier. Now the photons basically have joined atoms. Now they are both on the cutting edge of many-body physics. So what are the big, one of the big questions is, to understand what are the properties of fractional excitations on top of an FQH state. So you have heard several times that the fractional quantum Hall physics hosts fractional excitations, which means excitations which have a fractional charge, as well as in intermediate statistics in between photons and bosons and fermions, which means that when you exchange them, they don't get the plus one phase of bosons, they don't get the minus one of fermions, they get something which is more weird, which is I in the simplest case. Or if you go to even more complicated cases, they can even get some matricial valued phase to be the non-abelian ends. So this has been a big problem in condensed matter to get the direct evidence of the anionic statistics. The fractional charge has been observed on the edge on FQH by several groups now. Now the problem is to look at the excitation in the bulk, so make them exchange. Which, by the way, if you are in topological topological quantum information, is really the basic ingredient which is needed to develop a topological quantum. So, but for photons, you know, there is a key advantage is that the many body wave function is something which is accessible to optical measurement, because basically it's the relative phase between the vacuum and your state. So interferometry gives you access to this phase. And this was the first proposal by Onur. We're creating two holes in FQH, making them breathe around each other, and looking at the spectrum of the emitted light, one gets a small shift, which is proportional to the breathing phase. Of course, this is the kind of very science fiction experiment. If you want to understand things a bit more with your hands, this work by Alberto Munoz is very instructive, to my opinion, because it basically realizes that if you take two such fractional excitations and you just send them one against each other, and you look at the angular distribution of the reaction products, you see fringes whose position depends on the statistical phase of the particles. So to understand this, just think about fermions scattering between two fermionic particles. You know from your elementary quantum mechanics course that they cannot be scattering at 90 degrees because of summing of this process and this process, which have a sign minus for fermions, so they cancel out. For anions, the phase is not minus one, it's different. So this cancellation occurs at a different angle. So just by looking at the angle of scattering of two such quasi holes, you see that from this scattering angle, you see that the statistical phase can be inferred. This experiment has never been done. Now, several groups are trying to consider it for doing it either with photonic fluids, where you can use other atomic states to generate the impurity, or atomic fluids using impurity atoms in a different atomic gas to create the impurities. So this is an example of physics, which now is really open from the general point of view of many body physics. It's not that only the non-equilibrium counterpart is not known, but here the effect has never been observed in any kind of quantum fluid. So now the race is between atoms and photons to observe these physics. So here I have here we are, examples of experimental systems where these physics could be addressed. This is the lattice of cavities in a circuit QD device, where with a suitable combination of real magnetic fields, you can make photons to acquire phase when hopping around the plaquette. This is the atomic system with real atoms in an optical lattice, experiment by Markus Greiner, who have very recently observed some fractional quantum hole physics. And here also back to electronic systems, where in the meanwhile, while atomic and photonic systems were warming up their engine, also electronic systems have developed novel ways to investigate their systems. So there is now the race between all these platforms to observe these physics. So now I think it's time for me to conclude. So we have learned with this adventure on fluids of light, many interesting things in many body physics. Basically, we have learned that non-equilibrium and losses are not just a hindrance, can be a key advantage to manipulate the system and generate new states of matter without the need of cooling down the system. Because as you may know, that if you do a strongly correlated gas of ultra cold atoms, you have the problem that often the gas is too hot. And it's very difficult to cool down atomic gases below some temperature. So there is a block in temperature. Here you can use pumping and dissipation to go around this difficulty and go to very low effective temperature. So this is one of the power of our non-equilibrium systems, which then provide also a lot of techniques to investigate the physics and then probe their response to different probing, so to put into light properties which are normally escaping us for condensed matter systems, like the anionic statistics of excitations in an FQH cloud, which would be really important because it can become, in more sophisticated configurations, the platform to obtain topological quantum computing, where the topological nature of the state becomes the memory for the quantum information, which then is protected by the topology against external noise. So there are plenty of conceptual questions in this, especially if really the driving dissipation are not disturbing the physics. But this will be in the next seminar. With this, I thank you for your attention, and I'm here for questions.
All right. Thank you very much, Jacopo, for this really nice talk. Is there any question first in the room, and then we can go on to?
So no, he asked what family of FQH state is the one that John Simon has observed with his twisted cavity with two photons. So actually, this is so baby that is not does not belong to that family yet. But the best way of seeing what it is to look at the wave function, which is here, which closely resemble the one of two particles in the one alpha bosonic lattice, where the lattice, the state is Z1 minus Z2 to the power 2. That's say their objective. Then there are a lot of technical complications due to optics, because you have at the same time to deal with the optical imperfections of the system. But their objective is to have something which is Z1 minus Z2 times the Gaussian factor. So, and the key point why they could observe this state is that if you expand Z1 minus Z2, you get Z1 square, Z2 to the zero, Z1, Z2, Z2 to the square, Z2 to the square, Z1 to the zero, which basically means that you have either two particles in the state with angular momentum 1, or two particles in either L equal 2 or L equal 0. So one particle in L equal 2 and one in L equal 0, sorry. So 1, 1 or 2, 0. And the Laughlin state is a superposition of these two states, as is written here. And what the guys saw are the quantum correlations intrinsic to these two-body state. And this state is the lowest energy state because it's the only one which is non-interactive. All other states that you can create between two particles would be high in energy because they interact with each other. The amount of the gap is a good question. I don't know if I have marked it here, but perhaps we can see here. You see here, it's the gap. No, it's not marked here. I do remember by heart the number, but me or the order of megahertz. Because it's, you see, you have to, it's definitely larger than the lifetime of the photon in the cavity. Definitely larger than that. And you see here, all the properties are in the order of microseconds. That's the characteristic time of the decay, of the cavity dynamics. So in order to have a good blockade, you need that the interaction energy be larger than that.
Because I mean, the wave function you show the photon is entangled, right?
It has a two particle entanglement.
Show the topography essentially would show entanglement.
It's a kind of trivial entanglement between two particles. It's not really the entanglement that people would like to see in a many body system with all the complicated entanglement entropy scalings and all that. It's much more basic. It's at my level of understanding. But of course, things could be done in a more sophisticated way. There is a difficulty.
Can you repeat?
William asked whether John's experiment can be scaled to a larger number of particles. So actually, there is no fundamental limitation. The main difficulty is that the matrix element to create using a coherent pump a multi-photon FQH state goes down very fast with the number of particles. So, but nothing forbids, for instance, to do a three-particle state. In the numerics, we could. So it's, would say, a technical problem. Of course, I would hardly believe that this coherent pump scheme would serve to pump a 20-photon state. Because then really the macroscopicity of the state imposes some bounds on the matrix elements, and this kills you. For this reason, to do a bigger system is better to use this incoherent pumping with the two-level emitters. This has advantages, but it should scale up better to higher numbers. But life is not really that easy. Few papers which discuss some possible difficulties, but they're not major, more technical points. Let's see, photon blockade. Once he does photon blockade,
sky is the limit.
But yeah, say for his visible photons, it could be done, but it's technically difficult from the material point of view. Here for John's setup, in microwaves, you need to really assemble a lot of cavities together. It's a bottom-up technique, which can be difficult because of homogeneity of the sample. Or if you want to do it with Rydberg EIT, the setup is difficult because Rydberg atoms fill anything. So that's the really technical prowess of John being able to do that.
Perhaps if there is no other question, we can, okay. So we can, thanks once again, Jacopo.